Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures.
Hi, everybody. I was really tempted to do the Jonathan Cahn thing and be like, bam, I have 595 pages to do. But I didn't do that. For those of you who've ever seen Jonathan Cahn in person, he has this huge notebook that he brings out and like slams it on the podium. But anyways, so I just like to open us up in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the word that you have given us in all of its various forms, Bible, scroll, smartphone, whatever ways that we have. We thank you for the privilege of having your word, of being able to read it whenever we want, that we can have multiple copies of it, that we can carry it with us at all times. We ask that you would open up our ears, that you would open up my mouth to speak your praise and to speak your words, and that the message comes through would be yours and not mine. In Yeshua's name. So, as he said, my name is Elizabeth. I'm also the administrator here at Congregation Shema Yisrael. And in the past, I worked at a Christian bookstore, same one that Alan works at, Alpha and Omega. And I worked there for 9 years. And basically, we had training to sell Bibles pretty much every year, sometimes twice a year. So when, you know, we found out we were doing Simchat Torah, I was asked to talk on this because I've had some training in like Bible knowledge overview stuff. So like Rabbi said, today is Simchat Torah. This is the day when the Jewish community and celebrates the fact that we have been given God's word. And God, Simcha means joy, which it's the joy in the Torah. So it's our joy of having the Torah. And we should be extremely joyful about this because God has given us his word in the written form, but he's also given his word in the form of our Messiah because he is called the living word. So the word of God is especially important to us as believers because and has a life-changing effect on us if we read it and if we obey it. And I have seen this many, many times in my own life. It even started as far back as when I was a child. One of the ways that I would hear and interact with the scriptures was we had records. Yes, I did have records as a child. 8 tracks too, by the way. But they were old school. So it's called from a group called the New Creation Singers. I don't know if anybody's ever heard of them, but they do all, thanks. They do all scripture and song. So they just take usually Psalms, New Testament, Isaiah, stuff like that, and they just put it to scriptures. And I would listen to that as a child going to sleep because I always had a very hard time sleeping. I had a lot of nightmares and things, and so that would be a very soothing thing for me to listen to these scriptures. And actually, it's one of the reasons why the song Hiding Place that you guys sing always sounds wrong to me because they sang that same thing and a totally different tune, so I always get thrown off. But that was a way to get the scripture in. Like even as a child, and there, I can't tell you how many times, still as an adult, those songs come back to me, those scriptures come back to me when I need guidance or I need comfort, and or just even I've had times where I was praying about a gift for somebody and wanting to know a scripture to give to them, and those songs would come up. So if you don't ever do that, listening to scripture that's put to music can be a really good way to get that into your spirit. So I'm going to start out with a kind of overview of the Bible. The Bible is the divinely inspired word of God that was given to mankind. It's actually written by about 40 different authors throughout, which is really amazing when you think about the cohesiveness of the Bible, the fact that it was written by like 40 different people over several thousand of years, that it was so cohesive. It starts out with the creation of the universe. And then it ends with its destruction and the restoration of how it was supposed to be before sin entered into our realm. Now, our Christian tradition divides it into two sections, the Old and New Testament, or Covenant. But Messianic Jewish tradition considers it to be all one book. It's one continuous thing. One covenant builds upon the other. The Noah covenant builds on then the Abrahamic covenant, which then is built on by the Mosaic covenant, which is then built on by the New Covenant. It's a continuing thing. It's a growing thing. It's not divided. We refer to the Old Covenant as the Tanakh, and this is an acronym of the Torah, which is the first five books, the Nevi'im, which is the prophets, and the Ketuvim, which is the writings, and then the New Covenant, or the Brit Hadashah. And Brit Hadashah in Hebrew, Brit means covenant, and Hadashah means new. So the Tanakh was originally written in Hebrew, and the oldest manuscripts of the Brit Hadashah were written in Greek and Aramaic, although many believers believe it was originally written in Hebrew, and we just haven't found any of the original pieces yet. It is the primary way that God has revealed himself to us as human beings. It enables us to get to know him and to understand what he requires of us. We need to know God and his will so that he can fulfill his goal for our lives, which is to transform us into the image of Yeshua. If we don't know his words, then we can't be transformed. Many of the Bibles, I have one up here, it is heavy. Many of the Bibles will have an index in the front. This will sometimes change depending on what translation you're using. The TLV, for example, the Tree of Life, uses the traditional Jewish order of the books of the Bible, whereas some of the other ones change it around. So it can be a little confusing when you open that, but that's all right. And then there's also usually like maps and timelines in the back, which are super helpful if you ever get a chance to flip back there. So the Old Covenant is divided into various sections. There's the Torah, which is the first five books, and that's the historical section and the historical writings. There's the prophetic writings, that's the Nevi'im, and the poetic writings, which is the Ketuvim. So the Torah, or the Pentateuch, is the first five books. They're called the books of Moses because they were written by Moses. They tell the story of creation from the founding of, and the founding, through the founding of Israel as a nation. So that's like the timeline of that. It starts with the creation of the world and then goes through when Israel goes into the promised land. It also gives the law of the covenants, the Ten Commandments, the things that, the kosher laws, the things that the nation of Israel was to do in order to be set apart from all the other nations. Interestingly, the Torah does not actually mean law. It means instructions from God. And that's why we as Messianic Jews consider the whole Bible, the whole Old and New, to be Torah, because it is all instruction from God. So the Nevi'im, or the prophetic writings, were written by various authors, and the books are usually named after who wrote them, Isaiah, Jeremiah, that kind of thing. They tell the history of the nation of Israel from its founding through its dispersion by Babylon and then return back to the land. The prophetic writings also tell what is going to come for the nation of Israel and for the rest of the world. The poetic writings, or the Ketuvim, are written by various authors. It contains the minor prophets. It also includes Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and the Song of Solomon, which is the poetic part. And it includes books giving history during and after the Babylonian exile. The New Covenant, or the Brit Hadashah, begins with the birth of the Messiah, Yeshua. And the Gospels are actually the biography of Yeshua's time here on earth, and they're written by various Talmudim, or disciples of Yeshua. And you'll see there's some overlap in them, like various stories are repeated, but yet some of them don't have the same story. And there's actually, if you look at them, there's actually different purposes to each one. Like Matthew focuses very much on the prophetic fulfillments from the Old Testament. John focuses, I think it's more on like the human side. And so each one kind of has a different focus to it. Luke was the doctor, so he tended to focus more on like the physical healings and the physical things that went on. And so it's very interesting to compare and contrast what was going on. The Acts of the Apostles is the history of the Messianic community during the 30 years after Yeshua's death and his resurrection. So that's when the Messianic community was growing, when it was being formed, it was coming into being. The epistles, or the letters, are the mix of historical writings and exhortations, and those are given to the newly formed Messianic Jewish community, some to Jewish congregations and some to not. There were many Greek congregations that were formed that didn't really have many Messianic Jews in it, but they still read the Torah. And it ends with a prophetic book that describes the end of the world and the return of Yeshua. And it's interesting because most people either read Revelation when they were new believers because they're like, ooh, I want to know what's going to go happen, and you know, or they like don't read it at all because it's kind of confusing. So, but Revelation is an amazing book to read because it tells us what's coming and it tells us where we're going and where all of this will end up. So the New Testament also contains The rules that we as believers are to live by, our codes of conduct towards each other in our relationship with Yeshua, it's a way of learning from the people who came before us, because they had to make these decisions that we as Messianic believers make. Do we make the Gentiles be kosher or not kosher? Does everybody have to circumcise? How do we treat people who come and go? What do we do with issues, with problems? And it's all there, and we can use all of that to be there for our instruction. So as you can see, I have a continuum up here of the different translations. There's actually many different translations of the Bible, and I don't mean like into other languages. I mean different translations of how they put the words together. Obviously, because the Bible was originally written in Hebrew, Greek, and Aramaic, we did need to translate it into English, but there are two different thought processes with how they did it. So as you can see on the continuum up there, there's the word-for-word end and the thought-for-thought end. And the word-for-word end tries to keep as close to the original as possible. They don't add anything. They don't try and move things around. The thought-for-thought tries to get a complete thought across, even if they have to use words that aren't in the original text. And as you can see, the farthest ends are the interlinear, which is the word-for-word, and that will actually show you the Hebrew word opposite of the English word, so you can actually see it. And then I guess I consider the message to be the farthest at that end, because it's very paraphrased. We use the TLV, which you can see is very close to the word for word, and we also use the Jewish New Testament, the JNT, which is also at the end of the thought for thought, and we do that for a couple different reasons. But you can see, like, the NIV fits pretty much right in the middle. They're trying to balance the idea of word for word, thought for thought. Various others go back one way or the other, and it really just kind of looks kind of like what you're looking for. What are you trying to get? Like, you know, a lot of times we'll point newer believers to something that's more thought for thought because it's a little bit easier to understand. Some people stick only to the King James. That's like the only thing that's out there. But really, it kind of depends on what. And it's interesting to see the different translations and see what they chose to use for their verbiage. So we tend to use here the Tree of Life Bible, or the TLV, for the Tanakh, and that is a word-for-word translation. It attempts to put the Jewishness back in the Bible. It keeps the historical context. It keeps the ideas in Hebrew. It keeps the holidays using the Hebrew words. It tries to maintain the integrity of the Jewishness of these scriptures, which are actually very Jewish. It will use familiar but often inaccurate translations of names into English. So we get Jeremiah instead of Yirmiyahu, Matthew instead of Mariahu, which is a fun one to try and say. But they keep those so that they use the English words we're more familiar with, basically. But it keeps the Hebrew terms for the holidays, for the names of God, Elohim, Adonai Tzevaot, things like that, instead of translating those into English. They also tried to not add any additional words, so they're going to just use what words are there. They're not going to add anything more. And actually, the team that translated this, I found out as I was doing research for this, they actually went back to the original source material as often as they possibly could. They went back to the original Hebrew. They went back to the original Greek. They didn't go to like an earlier translation of the Bible. They went back as much as they could. So the Jewish New Testament, or the JNT, is a paraphrase. So that is the farthest end of the thought-for-thought continuum. It again attempts to put the Jewishness back into the Bible. It keeps the ideas in Hebrew, keeps concepts in Hebrew. However, it will use unfamiliar but more accurate translations of Hebrew names into English. Some of them you heard, but like it'll say Miriam instead of Mary, Creote instead of Iscariot, things like that. It'll keep the place names in Hebrew. Instead of translating Beit Lechem instead of Bethlehem, it'll keep that kind of thing. He also, David Stern, who did the translation, will use as many English words that are needed to get the point across. So if he feels like one of the best examples is when it says, knock and a door shall be open to you, he says, knock and keep on knocking. Because in the Greek tense, it's a continuous tense. It's not just a one-time thing. It's a keep doing this. And so he adds that to give you that feel. He also is very careful when he translates passages that are usually translated in a kind of anti-Semitic replacement theology way. He will reword those to get as much a point across of that's not what's going on. Romans in particular is very interesting to read. If you're used to reading it in a regular translation, it's very interesting to read that in the Jewish New Testament because of how he translates so many things. So the Bible impacts our lives in so many ways. It really does. It's pretty amazing. It's the number one bestseller, I think, ever in the history of mankind. And there's a reason for it. So one of the ways is it gives us knowledge. It's something that we should try and read daily, which can be a hard discipline to do, especially in our world right now with massive amounts of distraction. A couple different ways to do that. There's different reading plans. There is the Parsha, which is the Jewish reading cycle that is used in most synagogues around the world. Like basically every Jewish synagogue is reading the same part of the Bible at the same time. This reads through the complete Torah, the five books of Moses, every year. So they make it all the way through. They also will read the second selections from the rest of the Old Covenant and put those together. This starts at Simchat Torah, so it starts today, like we rolled back the scroll. That starts with moving back to Genesis and restarting the whole plan. The MJAA, or the Messianic Jewish Alliance of America, which most of us are a part of, also has a reading plan that they put out. It's out in the back if you need copies of it. This combines the Parsha and the rest of the Bible, and this helps you to read the Bible through in a year, which is a can be a difficult goal, but they break it up. So they tell you, like, okay, read this part on Monday, read this much on Tuesday, you know, and it gives you the breakdown, which makes it a bit easier. It takes a sequential selection from each of the different sections of the Bible. So it starts with the Tanakh, moves through the Brit Hadashah. And so you get, like, you know, you're going to read this part from Joshua, this part from Matthew, and then you're going to read the Parsha from Genesis and Isaiah. And so it kind of walks you through the whole thing. So it's really helpful if you are the kind of person who likes to check things off and have a little checklist, because then you know what you've read. So one way that is really great is to pray for understanding before you read. That's very important. So in Psalm 119:66, they say, next slide. There you go, Steve. It says, teach me good sense and knowledge, for I trust in your mitzvot. And then 2 Corinthians 2:10 says, but God revealed these things to us through the Ruach, for the Ruach searches all things, even the depths of God. So this is showing us that it if we trust it, if we go with it, if we follow his plans, then he's going to give us that knowledge that we're asking for, and it'll be through the Ruach, and he'll help us with that. It's really a good idea to read sequentially through each book, rather than just picking a few verses here and there and, like, you know, just running with those. Cherry-picking verses can lead to a lot of misunderstanding about what the Bible says, because a lot of times what's above what you just read and below what you just read changes totally what you're reading. So it's really a good idea to, like, check out what else is there. And it's also really not of a lot of value if you don't obey what's in there. Like, you can read it all you want, but if you don't obey it, it doesn't really help much. And the reasons is that obedience brings blessing. So Psalm 119, 1 to 3 says, blessed are those whose ways are blameless, who walk in the Torah of Adonai. Happy are those who keep his testimonies and who seek him with a whole heart and who also do no injustice but walk in his ways. If we walk in his ways and we obey the Torah, God has promised us blessing, and he has, even to the point where it says happiness. It's promised us happiness. And in this world, I don't know about you, but I could use a bit of happiness. I mean, the way things are going right now, it's not so great. So by walking in his Torah, by keeping his word, we can get that blessing and that happiness. I mean, Yeshua even said in his Sermon on the Mount in Luke 11:28, he said, rather blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it. So it's more than just hearing the word of God to receive blessings. You have to obey. You have to take it in. You have to interact with it by putting it into practice in our lives, because otherwise it's just any other book. It's just anything else that you have. So the Bible also gives us guidance for our relationship with God and with other people. It shows us how to relate to people, what we're expected to do, the laws we're expected to obey. It's the instruction manual for life. Now, I know, a lot of us don't read instruction manuals. We just, like, go ahead and do it. You get something to put together, and you're like, oh, I can do this, you know, and then you get halfway through, and you're like, oh, wait, I put tab B into slot C instead of in where I was supposed to and whatever. You have to go back and then read the instruction manual and figure out what you're supposed to do. So if you read it first, it kind of makes your life a little bit easier. So in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, it says, trust in Adonai with all of your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he'll make your paths straight. And I don't know about you, but I would rather have the God who knows everything and sees everything pointing me where I should be going, rather than trying to figure it out in my own limited knowledge, because I can see about that much, and God sees like that much. So he sees so much more than we can see, and he knows what's coming. Like, he might tell you, you know, turn left here or do something and you don't know it, but you find out later that there was a huge car accident at that spot. But we can't do that if we don't trust him, if we don't acknowledge him, if we don't give him our paths, because then he can't guide us. So John 14:26 also says, but the helper, the Ruach HaKodesh, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of everything that I said. And I don't know if you've ever heard, but there's a verse in the Bible that says, if everything that Yeshua said was written down, the book would be basically endless. And so it's up to the Ruach to bring these things forward, to bring them to our minds. And that's why it's so important that you have the gift of the Holy Spirit, because without that, he won't have him to teach you, to remind you, to say, hey, you know, this is what you should be doing. Or you talk to somebody and they're really struggling and you don't know what to say, and then a verse pops to your mind, or something, you know, that you think to say to them that really helps them. If you don't have the Ruach, you're not going to have that guidance. So it also, the Bible teaches us the way to think the way God thinks, because he thinks very differently than we do. I mean, we all talk about, like, men think differently than women and, you know, the whole nine yards. God thinks way differently than all of us. So we really, like, have to see that in there and understand that he's so far above us and beyond us that we're, like, well, even worse than, like, little children, worse than ants. I mean, like, comparatively, we got nothing on him. So in Psalm 119, 10 to 11, it says, with my whole heart I have sought you. Let me not stray from my mitzvot or commandments. I have treasured your word in my heart so I might not sin against you. And by changing our thinking to God's thinking, we can avoid a lot of the temptations and the pitfalls of this world. We can avoid getting into situations we shouldn't, that is going to harm us, that's going to harm other people. It's just a very, like, knowing all that is just so important. And it's not as intimidating as it sounds, because, like I said, the Ruach brings these things to your mind. And you can read something, forget it, and then later it just pops up, and you know that that was the Spirit. So also in Romans 12:2, the Bible tells us how this is accomplished. And it says, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God and what is good, acceptable, and perfect. And I always love that verse, because sometimes I'm like, well, you know, God's will is good and it's great for the universe. I'm not so sure it's so great for me, because my, what I want may not be what is, like, you know, in the cosmic scheme of things, really that important. But yet he says here that it will be good and acceptable and perfect. And so we have to trust that. That's really important. So this transformation takes place by reading his word and putting it into practice. And this is, I don't know if you guys have ever heard this phrase, but it's commonly referred to as the washing of the water of the word. So in other words, we're kind of washing out our old sinful thoughts. We're washing out our own impulses and washing in God's promises and promptings. It actually reminds me of that South Pacific song, I'm going to wash that man out of my hair. You know, it's just, it's, we're washing our brains with this, you know. It's coming through, it's changing our, we've even heard from Dr. Carolyn Leaf about the plasticity of the brain, and it's rerouting the channels, like water washing things away. And so it's so beneficial to do that. Just, even if it's just one scripture that you just say to yourself over and over and over, It transforms you. It changes you from the inside. Another benefit to knowing God's word is to know, because we can know when we know that, when we're hearing the truth, which is very, very important, because we have an enemy. And I don't know if all of you have run into this enemy. I feel like I run into him all the time. But Satan attempts to lie to us about our worth. He lies to us about our situation in life. He lies to us about how God sees us. He lies to us basically about anything that he possibly can, because that is who he is. He is the father of lies. And if we don't know the word, then we won't see those lies and we won't be able to refute them, because we won't know what it really says. We won't know what God really says about us. We won't know what is really going on, because if we don't have that backup, how do we know he's lying to us? But when we know what is written in scripture, we will also be able to discern, also besides when Satan lies to us, we'll be able to tell when people who are teaching are not telling us the correct thing. And that's very important, especially in this end times, when it says that the teachers will teach things that will tickle their ears, that will catch their fancy. And that's not the truth, because the truth is that the word of God doesn't really tickle our ears. And sometimes it doesn't catch our fancy because we don't want to hear it. We don't want to be told that we need to change. We don't want to be told that we need to grow. And so if we don't know the true word of God, we're not going to know when somebody is just telling us what we want to hear. So another way that the Bible is important is it reveals God's love to us. And it says it over and over and over throughout the whole Torah. And I'm just going to give you an example here. So Psalm 86:15, "But you, my Lord, are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, full of love and truth." Romans 5:8, "But God demonstrates his own love towards us, that while we were yet sinners, Messiah died for us." Romans 8:38 and 39, "For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God and Messiah Yeshua." Nothing comes between us and the love of God. And Ephesians 2, 4, and 5, "But God was rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us." Not the other way around, us. "Even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive in Messiah, and by grace we have been saved." And the list just goes on and on and on in the Bible of God saying, "I love you. You personally, you, every individual. I looked at this universe and I said, you need to be here right now at this time in this place. Not 100 years ago, not 100 years in the future, right here, right now." And that is so important to know and believe that. We have to really, really believe that God loves us. And that's so hard nowadays when we're told that we're not good enough, that our hair isn't the right color, that we're not wearing the right clothes, that we're not talking to the right people, that we're not going the right places, that we have to be afraid of absolutely everything. But the God of the universe made us the way we're supposed to be. He made us to look individually. Some of us are tall, some of us are short, some of us have brown hair, some of us have blonde hair. He made us that way. And I actually do believe that when each baby is created, he has a hand in choosing what he wants. I don't think it's random. I really don't. I think he really chooses each one of us. So because he loves us so, so very much, we could trust his guidance. We can trust that he's going to lead us where we're supposed to go. We can trust his provision. He's going to provide for us. He's not going to let us like starve on the streets. He's going to help us. He's going to provide for us. Even when it's really, really hard and it seems like we are going to like end up on the streets, or if we are on the streets, because I've met people who are living on the streets, somehow he still makes a way. He still does that. He also gives us his protection. And I'm not saying that bad things don't happen, because they do. And I've experienced them in my life. But he always turns it around somehow. He always brings it back. It always comes to good in some way or another, whether it's for your good or somebody else's good, because the bad things that happen in our life, many times we can then turn around and help somebody who's going through the same problem, going through the same process that we went through, because we went through it. So we know what they're going through. And so if we don't know that God loves us, we don't know that he's going to be there and do all those things. The other thing that it does is if we know God loves us, we can love other people. We can turn around and pass that love out to other people, which is so important in this world right now. I mean, it's important anyways, but it's always important. But we can give them grace, you know, and we can be kind when we're faced with a difficult person or a different difficult situation. We don't have to hold them to impossible standards, because honestly, who are we to hold them to those standards? Ava always says, who are you to judge somebody else's servant? Like, you know, really, we need to, I mean, I'm speaking me personally, need to work on that, because we hold people to these ideals and yet we shouldn't be, because God loves them the way they are and we're asked to love that way too. So we really should do that. And that's one of the ways actually that the Bible reveals the attitudes and beliefs and fears and sins in our life that God wants to change. And there have been many times where God has shown me that through my reading. I'll read something and I'm like, oops, okay, not doing that one. Like, I remember reading Proverbs 31 and verse 26 just like popped out at me, and it says, "She opens her mouth with wisdom, a lesson of kindness is on her tongue." And I was like, have I been doing that? I don't know if I've been doing that. So I read that and I was like, all right, I want to be remembered as a wise, kind woman, not as a critical woman, not as an unpleasant one that nobody wants to be around. So it's like, you know, those are the ways that God just points these things out and kind of taps you on the shoulder. And he's like, yep, that one. I want you to work on that one. And so how does this come about? Well, it comes through the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. This is how God helps us to understand and helps us to implement his word, because the Ruach makes it come to life. So you can be reading the Bible and you're reading a passage that you have read, I don't know, 50 times, who knows how many times, and all of a sudden you see something you never saw before. That's the Ruach. That's bringing it to life. It helps it to come up. It gives us the guidance to help us find the scriptures that relate to what we're dealing with. So if we go to the Bible and we need encouragement or comfort for ourselves or others, the Ruach helps us to find that. Often I'll read a scripture that applies to something that I'm dealing with, or I read something in my reading and then I talk to somebody and they're struggling with something that the verse that I just read will help them with it. And I can say, hey, I just read this. This is, you know, I'll pass this on to you. I just read this. And that really helps, because that's our way of ministering to people. And that's the way that God ministers to us through his Spirit. We also, it also helps us to remember what we've read, because we have so much going on right now. I feel like my attention capacity has dropped to like next to nothing with cell phones and all this kind of stuff. And everything's so instantaneous. Like, you know, it takes too long to go through the McDonald's drive-thru. You know, we just don't have the patience for that. But you know, so it's like trying to remember what's in the Bible can be difficult, but he helps us with that memorization. And actually, memorization is a powerful weapon in our arsenal to fight the enemy, because we can speak those words back to him. Even Yeshua quoted scripture when he was dealing with Hasatan. At the end of the 40 days when he was in the desert, the adversary tempted him with food, with protection, and with power. And he rebuked him by quoting Deuteronomy 6 and 8 and Psalm 91. And those scriptures are available to us just the same as they were available to him. And I personally have used scripture many times to fight off the attacks of the enemy. Recently, one that in the last couple years that has been extremely important to me that was brought to my attention was Romans 8:15. And this was when I was especially struggling with fear, and it's been instrumental in helping me fight off this spirit. Because it says, for you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. But on the contrary, you receive the Spirit who makes us sons, and by whose power we cry out, Abba, which means daddy, Abba Father. And this verse reminded me that I had already been set free of fear, and that I just needed to stand strong and stand firm on those attempts, because I was not going to fall back into that fear. I was not going to fall back into that slavery, but it was going to be a forward motion, and I just had to stand. When all else fails, the Bible says, just stand. And that was what I had to do, because Satan was trying to convince me, you can't handle this. You have gone, like, you've fallen back. You're never going to get out of this. You're stuck. You're never going to get beyond this. You're never going to be able to leave the house. You're never going to be able to eat that. You're never going to be able to go there. You're never going to be able to do those things. And it was all lies, total, complete, and utter lies. But if I didn't have those scriptures to fall back on, I would not have that to fight him. Because when I can't pray, when I don't have the words to pray, I can still bring up a scripture and just speak that scripture over myself and over my life. So really, scripture can only be understood and applied by the power of the Ruach, because it really takes more than just knowledge of scripture. I mean, there are many scholars out there, many biblical scholars, who can quote the Bible up and down. They know every different place. But you know what? They don't have a relationship with God. To them, it's just a scholarly tome. It's a book that was written, and that's all it is. So they don't have that relationship, and so it doesn't impact their life. It doesn't change them. It doesn't grow them. It doesn't move them forward. To them, it's just knowledge. It's just, it's like any other textbook. It's like any other, it's like the Odyssey. It's like whatever has been written in the past. So scripture has to come to life through the Ruach to us, because without that, it's not truly there. And like I previously stated in John 14:26, but the helper, the Ruach HaKodesh, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of everything that I've said. And that's why it's really important to continue and study the word, no matter how mature you are in the Lord. Like, we need to start with when we first become believers, and we need to continue until the day we die. Because he'll always show us something new. There's always something, like Rabbi Jim has said, he doesn't know how he keeps getting so many different things, even though he's been preaching for 25 years. He keeps getting fresh new things, and that is the Ruach. Because we will never, ever fully comprehend the mind of God. It's just not going to happen. there's always something new to discover. He's always got something new to say. He's always got something more for us. We're never finished completely. Like, even if we're the most mature spiritual believer in the world, there will still be something that God can be like, hey, yeah, we need to work on this. Or, you know, you need to learn this. Because it's an ever-growing, ever-changing thing that we have to have. So the Bible also contains many fulfilled predictions in history that historical records have come to pass. And this can give us a great deal of certainty about the reliability and the accuracy and the truth of the Bible, because we can look at those predictions and then look at history and say they actually happened. So some examples of these predictions concerning the nation of Israel is the Babylonian captivity, the destruction of the temple by Rome, the scattering of the nation of Israel around the world, otherwise known as the diaspora, the desolation of the land, the persecution where we were scattered to, the regathering of the nation of Israel back to the land, the restoring of the fruitfulness, and the continued hostility of the neighboring nations around them. The Bible is also full of predictions about our Messiah, all of which were fulfilled by Yeshua. Every single one of them either were fulfilled when he came the first time or they will be fulfilled the second time. And when Nehemiah restored the temple in Jerusalem after the Babylonian exile, he continued the tradition of reading the Torah as a form of worship. That began in Babylon, and they brought it back with them. Before that, they didn't really read the Torah in the temple. It was more about the sacrifices, but they didn't really read it. And what this did was it enabled all Jewish men to be literate. They all could read the Torah. They all knew it, which in that time period to have a literate society was actually quite unusual. A lot of the women did too, but all the men, they were very literate and they knew their scripture. Because when you have a scroll like that, you can't flip around. You can't decide, oh, I want to go read over here. Nope, you have to start and read. And if you try and, like, you need a point, you got to remember where it was, because you're not going to be rolling the scroll back and forth all the time. So they really had to know their scripture. And so they were able to recognize the Messiah when he came because they knew the prophecies. They knew what was written in the Bible about him. They knew what it was saying. Even in Matthew, it talks about when Herod asked the sages where the Messiah would be coming from. In Matthew 2, 4 to 6, it says, when he, Herod, had called together all the ruling Kohanim and the Torah scholars, he began to inquire of them, where will the Messiah be born? And he told them, in Bethlehem of Judea, for it is written in by the prophet, and you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. And they were quoting Micah and 2 Samuel. And they knew these prophecies. They knew what to look for. They knew when he was coming. And that enabled them to recognize him when he did come. And the disciples knew the predictions of the Messiah. I mean, that's how they recognized him. In John 1:45, it said, Philip found Nathanael and told him, we have found the one that Moses in the Torah and also the prophets wrote about, Yeshua of Netzaret, the son of Joseph. So they knew, they saw it. They knew the prophecies, they knew what was going on. And this memorization of scripture also enabled his disciples to go out in all the world and proclaim the good news without needing scrolls, without needing books, and they certainly didn't have smartphones, but they were able to take it with them in their mind. They were able to bring that word out to the rest of the world because they had it all memorized. The Bible also contains predictions about future times, which is very important to us right now because they give us hope. They show us where it's going, and this is a hope we very much need. They predict the return of the Messiah, and we need to know these predictions so that we can recognize when he's coming, because that's equally important to know when he's coming back the second time as it was to know when he came the first time. So in Luke 21:8, Yeshua is speaking to his Talmudim, and he says, watch out that you're not led astray, for many will come in my name, saying, I am he, and the time is near, but do not follow them. And when you hear of wars and chaos, do not be terrorized, for these things need to happen first, but the end will not come at once. And then he goes on to list all the things that will happen in the end of days: wars, plagues, famine, persecutions, surging of the seas, otherwise known as tsunamis, and all of this. Does this sound familiar? Sound like what we're dealing with right now? We're getting there. And so he ends by saying in Luke 21:28, now when these things begin to happen, stand up straight, lift up your head, because your salvation is near. He's telling us, don't be afraid when you see all these awful things, because it just means I'm coming. I'm going to be here soon. And that's the hope and the strength that we can take from this, from the Bible, from all of this. Because in the end, folks, we win. We win. Like, That is so important to know, that no matter what junk goes on, no matter what's happening, we win. In the end, he wins. He will return to rule and reign for eternity. He will remake this earth into what it was supposed to be, and we will be glorified with him. And our great hope is written out in the last chapter of Revelations, and that's Revelations 22, 1 through 4. And it says, "Then the angel showed me a river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the city streets. On either side of the river was a tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in the city, and his servants shall serve him. They shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. Night shall be no more, and people will have no need for lamplight or sunlight, for Adonai Elohim will shine on them, and they shall reign forever and ever." So when things appear crazy and scary, like they are pretty much now, we need to remember he's coming back and that he will take us with him when he comes. He has everything under control, no matter how chaotic it seems and no matter how dark it seems. In the end, he has it all under control and he wins. Satan gets thrown in the pit and we get to spend forever worshiping him. So, amen. So we need to make sure that we are clean of all the sin that would keep us from spending that wonderful eternity with Yeshua and with God, so that we will be there with him to see him in all of his glory. And in order to do this, we have to regularly confess our sins to him and allow him to make us a new creation in his image. So if you aren't sure that this applies to you, that you have been set free of the sin and that you're clean and that you'll go with him when he comes back, I would like to pray for you. So Heavenly Father, I would like you to pray this with me. Heavenly Father, I want to be with you for eternity, to see you reign in majesty. Please come now into my heart and take your place as my Lord and Savior. Please forgive me for the sins that I have committed against you and against your word and against others. Wash me of my sins and make me pure in your eyes. I give you authority over my life and my heart, and I ask you to guide me in your wisdom and your truth. Thank you that you love me and you want only the best for me. Thank you for sending your son to die for my sins so that I can be with you forever. And I ask all of this in Yeshua's mighty name. And now I'd like to pray for the rest of you who have already received this gift of salvation. Heavenly Father, I thank you for giving us your word. Thank you for those who preserved it even at the cost of their own lives. Thank you that the increase in technology has made this word universally available. And thank you for the hope that the Bible gives us. Please help us to be disciplined and to read your word regularly. Thank you, Ruach HaKodesh, for making the word come alive to us. And please give us revelation from your word. And I come against any spirits of distraction, of busyness, of deception, of fear or confusion that would prevent us from reading the word. Please help us all to gain hope from the Bible and to develop an intimate relationship with you through regular readings of your word. And I ask these things in the name of Yeshua. Amen.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670 or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service. Saturday morning, complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bengals and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.